I'd like to welcome everyone to the fourth webinar for the Leadership Excellence series. This one is on conflicts of interest. So this is our last webinar of the day. And I am Spencer Brigham, the Training and Events Administrator for AFOA Canada. I'm going to start with a short land acknowledgement. So welcome everyone and thank you for being here. I would like to acknowledge that we are on the traditional territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe. This land continues to be home to diverse Indigenous peoples, whom we recognize as contemporary stewards of the land and vital contributors of our society. We honor the traditional lands and homelands of Indigenous peoples and communities across Canada, including First Nations, Inuit, and Métis, living both on and off reserve in rural and urban communities. And just a bit about myself, I'm Ojibwe. I'm from Walpole Island First Nation in Ontario, also known as Bekedrenong. And with that, I'll pass it over to Harold Tarbell.
Thank you very much, Spencer, and welcome everyone to the AFOA Canada Conflicts of Interest, How to Manage Them Effectively webinar. My name is Harold Tarbell. I'm a Mohawk from the community of Akwesasne, and I'm pleased to be able to join you from the Squamish Nation territory here in North Vancouver. Just by way of a quick background, I've worked with the AFOA for quite some time and done a lot of work around their strategic planning and their conference work and their community development, professional community development workshops as well. I'm a former chief in my community a few decades ago now. And I've worked with worked for and with a number of lawyers over the course of my career. In terms of conflict, having been in the chief's position, I've experienced sort of both the potential of conflict and the perception of conflict. And so sort of bring that to bear. I've been on a number of boards over the course of my career as well. And I'm currently on the Institute for Cultural Affairs Corporate Board, which is a facilitation group out of Toronto with there's a network of institutes around the world. Our job is to sort of work with them around increasing the business that this facilitation company generates. And so as a facilitator on the board, I have to be very conscientious about, again, the perception of conflict or the fact where my interest as a professional facilitator might run contrary to the interests of the board for the Institute of Cultural Affairs. So I just want to note that I am not a lawyer. I am a facilitator, chair, strategic planner. But again, having worked my entire career with our peoples and in the Indigenous communities. So Spencer's going to share the PowerPoint on this one. And just as he's getting that ready, I'll and moving through it. Again, we're going to look at conflict of interest, some tips and tools in terms of proactively managing those situations when they are present. And of course, for many of us, they are always could be present. And then, when we get into that situation, what are some strategies for dealing with that? So just jumping in terms of conflict of interest, we kind of begin by taking a step back and then taking a look at what we mean by ethics, morals, and values, because there is a great connection to what are potentially, what conflict of interest is and what potentially that could mean for the work that we do. So here, ethics, the rules of conduct, the societal rules of conduct and behavior that are there. So again, guides. Morals essentially are internal values which guide our behavior and our understandings of right and wrong. And then values, again, those, so you say morals are a set of values. Values are those beliefs that we have, which guide our behavior. And so you see in this one, there are guiding principles that guide our actions and our decisions. It's technically, there's a distinction between values, which again, are beliefs, and principles, which can often be seen more as natural laws. So a little bit more permanency to them, or objectivity to them in some respects. But as I said in strategic planning, for example, where we look at that and you'll see principles and value statements, it's often a distinction without a difference in the sense that essentially what they are both doing is helping to guide our behavior. And so that, of course, then leads us into this conversation about what is conflict. And so let's go to the next slide. And so again, the reason conflict of interest is it's the most common ethical violation that arises for us and situation that arises and where those breaches occur. So was when we act more for our individual benefit or our own interests or our own loyalties rather than to our responsibility in a board or governance situation to the collective group, as in my case with the Institute for Cultural Affairs, or to our community whom we are accountable to. And so that's but where that plays out and what a breach is when we as an individual or an individual does engage in that. It'll give you some greater insight on the next slide in terms of where these situations kind of occur for us. So again, our personal interests conflict with our professional responsibilities, where our decisions in our professional capacity in a way benefit or advantage the people we're loyal to and potentially disadvantage others. And then in our positions of authority, and you can see how this could be particularly at a board level and a governance level, but it could also work in a at an administration's program level, it could work in a other entities as well. And this kind of starts to get to, you know, how often we can encounter these is that we often don't do just one thing. And often when I look at sort of the younger generations, I notice that many of them have what I would call multiple business lines in terms of where they are engaged. And in some respects, more so than, let's say, my generation. But, you know, what we're trying to get there is that when our position in authority sort of conflicts with my interests in another organization. The other thing we'll touch on at some point is, you know, where this arises is the perception of conflict. And we'll touch on that in just a little bit as well. Let's go to the next slide. It's an example, which I'll ask you to think about a little bit. So your cousin, which in my case is pretty much everybody in my 15,000 person community, has established his or her own information technology consulting business. Let's say in some way, shape or form, I'm connected to the council or to the administration, but we haven't issued the request for proposal yet, but one's coming along and I know about it. So I arranged for my current IT director to give my cousin the behind the scenes tour, ostensibly unconnected to that, but you know, but I do know that he's interested in bidding on the contract which has been issued. So if you think of those situations, right, our personal interests conflict, our decisions in a professional capacity affect people that we are loyal to or potentially disadvantage others, or we're working towards our own interests, which could be a dynamic here, and we haven't seen it yet. On this example, what it really talks to is it is the you in this. So your cousin, so whoever you are, you're the one who's engaging in the breach. The other person is not necessarily engaging in a conflict of interest at that point, but they may be in fact violating the RFP process or setting them up for repercussions a little bit later. And we do have a slide which talks about that a bit later in the slide as well. On the next slide, we kind of try to get into the effect of how pervasive they could be in our, particularly in First Nations community and Indigenous groups, given our, our small size and our locations often, and, our relationships and through many ways, shapes and forms. You notice it said who you're loyal to. It didn't necessarily say who you're related to. And, nepotism does become an area where, you can be in conflict. So, but again, it suggests there's broader areas than just supervising your own relatives or benefiting your own relatives. The fact that there are these many interests and loyalties and participation avenues and potential conflict situations is not necessarily the problem. It's a complication, but it's not the breach. And so it's when you breach them. And so what they're talking about here is, so you got to be aware of them. You got to, do some introspection, really. You've got to proactively manage. So try to get ahead of that. And, you can see how that plays out individually, organizationally, situationally. So we do talk here in this one where often it comes to family members. You have to decide which family gets a band-owned house based on an assessment of needs. And in the mix is your relatives and other band members. So you can, again, see where that plays out. I would probably say the only saving grace, and it's a sad saving grace, is we don't have that many houses to go around. So sometimes, based on need, it may not be our relatives. But really, what do we mean by proactively manage that? We'll talk about recusing, stepping out of that decision-making process or necessarily trying to influence that process. We'll also talk about just making sure that that process and, let's say, policy and procedure is well-defined. And so, the guardrails are there to help you navigate that situation. Let's go to the next slide. Yeah, so again, re-emphasizing the fact that we often, both as council members and employees, in some respects have these unavoidable situations where there's a potential for conflict of interest or for the conflict to be perceived. And politically, the perception of conflict is a real challenge for you. And I've seen that really undermine a lot of good work where there's that perception. Nepotism's a good one there, where so essentially the proactive there is often it's unavoidable that our relatives work in the administration which we are governing or managing. And so there's some guardrails there. You shouldn't be in a supervisory position where you're giving direct supervision and control over your immediate family or close relative. And so there's some guardrails there. There's another dynamic we'll encounter that a lot of times what happens is, again, given the lack of resources, oftentimes our governing board or our council is in fact employed not as counselors and as chiefs, but as program managers and staff inside the very administration which they are setting the employment policies for. And so again, that's a fascinating area. And just that ideal of how do we proactively manage, which in some cases is avoidable, but in some other cases is not avoidable. And those hard decisions you know, that would have to be made. But again, just that piece about the perception of it. And so what we talk about here is relates to you in terms of being in breach of the conflict, but also relates to the implications for the other party who could suffer repercussions elsewhere, loss of employment, loss of an ability to bid, you know, are a couple of examples that, you know, come to mind. So they're just on this particular bullet point. Failure to deal with these situations appropriately could have devastating effects organizationally, individually, transactionally. So there is some good news. Oh, by the way, just on the perception as well, one note, again, I'm not a lawyer, but I do recall a couple of places where that in fact has become a bit of an argument in some situations where the, you know, where it did deteriorate to a legal situation. So that perception of conflict. You know, another one I actually experienced was as a chief being accused in a suit about operating under the color of law to advance my own personal interests rather than the, abiding by our constitution and, you know, lawmaking authority. Yeah, it was more of a political dynamic we dealt with, so my record's clean. But let's look at some of these potential tools that we could look at. So, how do you proactively manage with that? Time and time again, you'll come down to policies and procedures, documenting your practices, engaging in the necessary research to clarify what are the issues where you need policies, procedures, coming up with those range of options which could work in those situations. The other important thing I would say about developing the policy is don't develop it in the midst of a conflict of interest situation, breach. So in that kind of crisis, that's the worst time to develop policy because then it tends to be very focused and specific. And, you know, in some respect, by trying to do that in the midst of the crisis, let's call it, it just muddles the waters a little bit. Policy is best built in the boring times, really. So again, that policy, here's another one that's a good board practice and doesn't hurt from a council perspective as well. Just kind of make that a declaration piece, like self-declaration, a verbal declaration, responding to a question about whether it's there. And sometimes there's a bit of an analysis to be done about whether that is a conflict or the perception of conflict, you know, which are slightly different things. So, but really, you know, look at doing that. And then there's techniques that you could do. We'll come to those. Of course, the more standard one I think we're all used to is recuse yourself from that particular discussion, and particularly the decisions and the decisions that are made about that. I've seen chairs do that, turn over the chair to the vice chair or someone else and exit the room where they had a real conflict of interest. So for example, in the case I'm thinking about, the chair was the member of another organization and it was talking about a partnership agreement or some, it might have been a legal agreement we had with that organization, and the chair noted that and turned over the chair to the vice chair. And we then proceeded, continuing with our quorum and made the necessary decisions there. And then he was re-invited back in, informed of the decision and picked up the chair role. Again, he was the elected chair in that circumstances. Let's say bigger, the guardrails for proactively managing and some of the little techniques you can use meeting by meeting, situation by situation to help you understand and navigate and identify when that potential is there. In terms of the next slide, this talk, in some respects, it talks about, let's say, the introspection we need to do when we're trying to figure out if there is a potential conflict. And, you know, when we talked about those definitions, it kind of gave those examples. And those definitions we talked about did sort of, when you think about it, they did highlight these particular areas where conflict of interest could be encountered. Employment, business, our political activities, partisan affiliations, so in terms of organized political parties, for example, family, community involvement, personal relationships. You know, again, I think what is nice about this is it does sort of give us a sort of a bundle of that. On the business one, and the business one in particular, then could be a financial, again, a financial interest that comes out of that. And so that's another big ticket area where you'll often run into that interest beyond the personal loyalties sort of thing. Do you need to resign from something to avoid a conflict of interest? I would say that's the nuclear option. And sometimes that is the option that's necessary. The other one, you know, the other end of that is the simple declaration and the recusing from the process. In some of our communities, you know, that kind of, if we had to resign every time there was that conflict or potential conflict and we didn't have the guardrails for it, we'd be having elections every, you know, we just have this constant cycle of elections. There would be no way around it. So the other thing is when, you know, let's say you have organizational conflict, you're going to give you a clear option. You might want to resign from the other one, but you never know. The other one might be where you're getting your greater financial benefit. So again, it's a challenge. But I think the answer is that's not always necessary. And again, if you have the good, you thought it through individually, the organization has created the policies and the guardrails for you. The process by which you would go through once that's happened or once that's claimed, then, you know, if that's clear, then, you know, then I think that's a lot easier. And a lot of that happens to you if found to be in a breach. So this is a question to avoid a conflict. There's another thing, if found to be in a breach, now that's another matter and in terms of the enforcement and the repercussions that also might be legally policy or norms very clear, or it might be a judgment call again. So just as a, you know, again, as you look to, you know, give an objective look at this, even though it can apply to us so personally, those are some of the things that you've got to consider. In terms of conflict of interest, our next slide is conflict of interest of board members. Really, you'll see the similarities here and, you know, the context of conflict of interest and ethics issues in a policy context. And in some respects, this might be the best practices for board governance and, you know, the things they talk about in those policy governance models or which the directors college who certifies board directors would then get into and, well, you know, things to do. So declaring our own conflicts or conflicts with other board members if they are not declared, right? So, you know, finding diplomatic ways to ask that question or procedural ways where that gets brought to the surface. That's often a process that boards will go in where you have to disclose. So again, if you're ever getting on a financial trust, where you have to manage other people's money. Some of those things you do have to, or invest other people's money, and then use that money for specific purposes, let's say the interest on that money, you often are required to do that. And that's part of the sort of, let's say, the legal procedures there. Things change, so keeping that up to date. I think sometimes it's hard on this one, and it, you know, to keep it up to date. And then it's also quite difficult when we want to think about policy, because as I say, policy is best developed in the boring times. And so therefore policy development often gets little attention. So, again, just trying to find a way to make sure that you're bringing your attention back to this. Yeah, the excluded from the discussions, that's a whole recusing from that. Recusing sort of suggests that you are doing it. Excluded means they are doing it, so that kind of thing. And then it gets to that part where if in fact the conflicts are occurring and not just potential, then the board member should resign. So again, that's at the board, on the board best practices side. On the council side, which is essentially a board, when you look at program administration and financial management, but it's also a government, that it's a little fuzzier there in when that should happen. Oftentimes, where we see it on the council side or our government side is when there's recall provisions with stated causes upon which recall can be done. We don't have a lot of those, but there are some good examples where those provisions are there. The other piece of the policy, and of course connecting back to the ethical piece, is an ethics code of ethics or an ethical conduct policy, which is our next slide here. And so, is there a need for one? To me, it defines some guardrails. So, and it does, it's almost, if you think of it, it's almost a precursor for what my conflict of interest policy would do. But in terms of that definition of ethics and values that we talked about earlier, acceptable standards or acceptable behavior, high standards, support self-evaluation, give us some guidance and the guardrails we got to stay between, framework, a policy framework. Guardrails is my word of the day, I guess. So, and then what do you put in it? Principles, practices, what the organization is and aspires to be. And that whole point that is there, but it needs the relationship and the interconnection with other policies and procedures, particularly on the, the application side, need to be there as well. So it doesn't stand alone, works in conjunction, and really helps you figure out how you treat your employees, your clients, your partners, your vendors, and any others that may fit into that constellation of many potential conflicts, situations that you could encounter, reasonably expect to encounter in your term on the board or your term as a counselor or in your role in management. The other one, I would say the other connection, of course, not just to the conflict of interest one, but is to a lot of the HR policies and that implications to the other person caught up in it could be in terms of ability to participate in the RFP policies and procurement processes or purchasing processes of your organization. So again, there could be a real economic backlash to that. You never know, it could be an issue which prevents you from running for council, depending on how it's defined. And then all of that leads you, the conduct and treatment of employees. So that's really about how you would apply the process, how you would enforce the process, how you would generate the information you need so that the group could make the necessary decision. Sometimes it's an outside expert, sometimes it's assigned. There's a luxury of an ethics officer. I know we have an ethics commission in my tribe back home, and an ethics commissioner who is called on when there's a situation and who empanels a group when he determines that there has been a breach And then they deal with it. So in order to create an arm's length from the chief in council in that case. So again, what are those steps, if you were, that you need to go through? And what's the structures and procedures that you put in place to support that? In terms of thinking about and addressing conflict, the role, how you approach it as a council member or as a senior manager is pretty critical. So let's shift to the next slide, which talks about tone at the top matters. So, and it does.
Okay, sorry, just to interject here, we have a question in the Q&A. Did you see that one yet? It's from an anonymous attendee.
Okay, let me open that up.
Okay, so I'll read it. In smaller nations, what are your thoughts on nation employees being on council at the same time? Is there a way to manage conflicts of interest? Often First Nations employ the brightest and most qualified in the nation, leaving the councillor pool less skilled.
Yeah, well, I've seen it a lot. I've seen it a number of times. I've also seen it where councillors are then assigned to run businesses and other entities owned by the council. To me, be nice to avoid it, but I think you just have to be upfront about it, and that's where policies and procedures can really be a saving grace. As the slides have kind of suggested, they're in and around us all the time, and it's about how do we proactively manage and navigate them. I would say, particularly in that situation, you do need an executive level senior manager, and you know, an incredibly experienced that way, because that's a tough place to be in. And then I think you would need really well defined ethics codes and conflict of interest, and you know, all of that. So like. Open up and look at that situation and describe it and create as fair a situation as you can. So I think, you know, as opposed to looking at it, either they should be or they shouldn't be, I'll often say in strategic planning, to me, that and in problem solving, that's a key component of it, is to get away from either or and see if there are creative solutions that could be done. But generally, our default position is either or. And the other one I've seen a lot of, we like to shoot all over each other. Should this, shouldn't that? And again, that gets us really into an either or situation. And from, let's say, from an interest-based approach to, you know, getting to solutions, shifting away from that is pretty critical. So I haven't done any work in that area, but I think it can be manageable. It does really then come back to this whole thing about the council's role in conduct, because that they're going to be the ones who really have to do the introspection and be as disciplined as possible when addressing that particular policy. And so I say you need an executive level person, really, who's kind of got that, either maybe has some previous council experience or has sort of operated as, you know, done that, change management kind of stuff, and knows how to navigate the difficult tensions of that kind of situation. So again, I would put that more in the executive management, executive leadership role. You really need them to weigh in on that and help you to do that. So, because, you know, those communities aren't going to magically grow, and there aren't going to be magical numbers of people suddenly going to some of our isolated and remote communities. And so you often in strategic planning, we'll talk about that, you have to strategize to respond to the situation, the environment that you are in. The best practices of boards in a policy governance role at the Director's College are informative, but it's up to us to then make sure that they work for us, and that I think we are growing up in where we want to be fair, right? So this other one here about sort of the in the chat, the issue about how do I get beyond my personal interest, my community interest, my regional interest, and really focus on the collective interest of the board or the organization or the tribal council that I'm on. And so that's really hard work as well. You can see underneath all that there could be some conflict situations, but there is, again, in that policy model, there is a need at some point. You can assert your regional interests, for example, but in the end, you have to make national decisions in the best interest of the organization that you are on the governing board of, whether it's a nation, a tribal council, a political, regional organization, a national entity, a corporation, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That is a hard lesson to learn, but that is a skill that we have to develop. Again, to get us from where we are and sort of, let's say, the nature of our political discourse and the character of our political discourse in our communities, whatever that may be, wherever that is at, we do have to sort of, in a way, bravely put our finger on the issue, conscientiously do the planning, research, and problem-solving process that derives reasonable recommendations, which we would then formally adopt and then ensure that we can properly enforce. So again, in an ideal world, that's where you want to be. And then, of course, we just make it. And so on that last part of that question there, but whether a member should inquire, so that was noted. Yes, you do declare. Hopefully the process has helped you to do that. But if you know of one, it may be, I would say there's a strategy involved. Yes, often there is a procedure where it is pointed out, but it is that idea of the strategic break, taking a break, having a conversation, encouraging that, clarifying what the breach, what the potential is, and encouraging that person to identify that, that's important. That can be an important way. So it doesn't all, like the whole part of that process doesn't all have to happen at the council table while in formal session. There could be other ways to sort of navigate so that while in formal session, it is, you're able to more effectively deal with it as opposed to spending all of our time arguing about it before we actually can do anything about it or address the agenda item where it came up. Our board representatives are appointed by constituent organization. Is there a template? I'm not sure. Maybe if you could provide a little bit more clarity on that in your chat, surely that would be helpful on that. All right, let's see the rest of this slide. So again, just carrying that out, right? If we're not very visible, we're often talked about, and we're often the bane of everyone's existence or the blame for everything. It is the burden we willingly take on when we put our name forward. Yeah. Scrutinized, copied. So again, that tone matters. And in some respect, we are trying to change the nature and character of our politics and elevate it as well. Thank you, Usher. I'm glad I got to that. We are trying to elevate it as well. So we can model it in how we conduct ourselves and how we behave. And those would be, those are good practices then to pass on to the incoming generations and members, as opposed to sort of some of those Robert's Rules myths that exist out there about how we should be conducting ourselves in the meetings themselves. Set the tone on ethics and conflict of interest through policies and codes, and really just, how we're going to deal with those really complicated situations which could evolve. To me, shining light on that is and being prepared to help be willing, like I said, put your finger on the issue, but engage in the constructive conversation is pretty important. You know, there's always the expertise you need to bring to bear in terms of drafting, in terms of analysis. There's legal considerations as well that you've got to deal with. And in some respects, if we were, theoretically, if we were able to deal with this more effectively this way, it could also help us a lot with sort of a lot of the inter-council legal fights that we do see happening a lot or on a, you know, on a number of occasions in our communities across the country. The decisions will often be judged against, your codes and your policies. So there is that level of accountability there. And having a policy is important. Actually applying the policy or enforcing the policy, ensuring that there is compliance, those are really important values. Sometimes having the policy, putting your finger on the issue will resolve it and, you know, people will adjust. But sometimes you do need to carry the process through and there needs to be a declaration. Yes, there is a breach and there needs to be those necessary adjustments or repercussions. But that does create new norms for the group. And so, you know, there can be a value through struggling through that often incredibly uncomfortable, intense filled process. But I guess that's the shining light, the light at the end of the tunnel is that this in fact can become a good norm and makes the next one easier. I use that word carefully in political and governing context. The last thing I'll say here is this reminds me sometimes in financial management, we talk about the fraud triangle, means, motive, and opportunity. And it's often the people at the top. Audits actually will only catch about 15% of fraud. It's more often the people participating in the fraud who reveal it. But what often happens, it's, there is that triangle, means, motive, opportunity, but, and I may not be stating it quite accurately, I don't have it in front of me, but what I see happening in there is our ability to rationalize our behavior, that we're doing okay, despite what the law might say or the policy or procedures might say, is a pretty powerful thing. And so sometimes it's important, that willingness to engage in that conversation, to really enforce, to create those new norms, that becomes also a powerful hedge to that. So in some respect, you're asking me to engage in some serious introspection and to police myself. And, I'm quite prepared to do that. I will defend my own interests, it's hard to be objective about yourself. So, bringing in supports to help you do that, somebody else, that you trust to assess where it is, somebody else, that the group trusts to create those policies and procedures, that might be an effective tool as well. And here's the other piece on this, so the public transparency piece about it. A lot of times we like to take these conflict of interest into the in-camera meetings, or we don't like to, report on them a lot. Sometimes, that conflict of interest gets waved around a lot in the in our public meetings sometimes. But you really do got to share information. I think you got to be, this really talks about sort of being conscientious about this. You want to be careful. You want to be careful about confidentiality, but want to make sure that one, people know that you're doing something, that they understand that it's going to be reasonable, that there's a predictable process to it, so you do want to get it there. then this talks about where, you know, where this can occur and, you know, what are some of those repercussions, right? So make sure you enforce the policy. So this one's the procurement policy they use at the bottom. Get three bids for larger budget proposals, larger projects. It's kind of the gold standard on that. You know, you do got to be careful. So people bidding, sometimes we'll often say we know when we're bidding, whether it's a real bid or whether there's already been a decision made. So that's not quite, that's not necessarily a conflict of interest, but, you know, just be, you know, clear, you know, conscientious about that. But if my cousin, who I gave him the backroom tour, suddenly puts in the most amazing proposal, and, you know, far exceeds, you know, anything you've seen from the other bids, well, then, you know, that might require some investigation, some analysis, at least, and some, you know, tough conversations. Or there's a school of thought, there's a trading thing called crucial conversations, and I do like that. So it's really about how you navigate and engage in those conversations around what I like to call our delicate issues that we have to deal with. All right, responding. Again, there's a few things in there. Take a look at that. Go to the next slide. Yeah, and so when you look at this one, it is getting to that piece about what does your informed decision-making process look like? Are you, getting the necessary information? Are you able to analyze it? Do you create the range of options upon which you make your decisions? And so making good ethical decisions requires that sort of exploration. The second one really comes back to the piece that it becomes norms, right? Becomes our conventions, becomes our normal practice, really. If you're just have a good process and you use a good process and everybody participates effectively in that process, it becomes our organizational culture, right? So our organizational norms, it's the way we do things. We do need to sort of, I think the whole part of these kinds of trainings that we recognize and commit to the fact that we need to up our game in terms of our how we operate our governments and our administrations and our how we operate professionally within a culturally informed and safe environment. An example of adherence to FAL, financial administration laws, is there. One good example we like to use in financial manager training is purchase orders before the purchase. It's a little thing, but it's the more, and people often get quite annoyed by it. I know it's the bane of many finance offices, but it really does help to manage it. Another good example is a number of First Nations have received ISO certification in terms of their system and in terms of their performance in their system. And when you look at the First Nations Manager Board, which talks about the financial administration law, they do that kind of certification as well on the finance side. Is the system well set up? Are the policies there? And are they being applied properly? So when you look at ISO, like Member 2 First Nation, that's a big case on that one. That'll be an example of that one. It really was organization-wide. I think Sagamuck First Nation also went through that process a few years ago, and it's something you do also have to keep renewing that and updating that. But it's a nice way. It's a bit of an investment to get that, but it is, again, worth it for that as well. All right, let's move to the next slide. Ah, yes, ethical dilemmas. Again, I hope he's dealing with them, assessing them, problem solving around them. And I do, you know, mention that often, issue, research, clarification, options, decisions, implementation, assessment, all of those things happen in there. And that, you know, in many ways, on a more personal level, almost, you are trying to apply that here. So, yeah, try to find out if your values are in conflict. And here are some of them. Get the facts. Be able to apply some metric to it. And a lot of times on conflict of interest, the way I've experienced it is people talk about it in such personal terms and personalize it so much. Try to find a way to, as a facilitator, I say, like, let's get to the issue. And in problem solving, we try to find the underlying issue, not the presenting symptom. Try to get to there. And then on policy process, you want to try to get to that. It doesn't matter who it is. It is really, there's a good process and guardrails for that. But you do see that sort of problem solving process in there. And in a way, the benefit of having a good conflict of interest process, problem solving, ethical dilemma process for you. Builds confidence, creates better cultural norms or operating norms, et cetera. Balancing rights and ethics. You do see that debate come up. I have the right to do this. But as we'll see on the next slide, there's also, you know, comes with the responsibilities we have. And so this here, we're just trying to, again, as we talked about ethics and morals and values, and try to get a context to that. You also, it's important to know that, because these issues will come up. There are individual rights, there are legal rights, there's sort of administrative fairness and procedural fairness that you've got to factor into this. There's collective rights that you're also balancing both as a board and as a council. But oftentimes, when we're looking at the exercise of rights on the economic side, for example, or the land use side, we've got to find a balance for the collective rights of our community as a whole versus the individual rights of our members themselves. Particularly, that comes to play a lot for us when we are asserting sovereignty and jurisdiction. One example I'll use is, I've been a lot of talk about cannabis, and a lot of times our retailers get out in front of us as a government. But in the end, I know in BC they've done quite a bit of work around this, around developing a First Nations cannabis strategy. But in the end, what happened was, my conclusion, having facilitated those sessions, was regardless of the sovereignty approach you take, whether you want to be individually sovereign or you want to be ultimately First Nation sovereign, or whether you want to be nation-based sovereign, or whether you want to go under the provincial jurisdiction, or whether you want to go under federal jurisdiction, or whether you want to try a tripartite thing, no matter what stream you're under, when you get into this, whether it's conflict of interest or whether it's business, you still got to apply that professional process to it. On the business side, it's the feasibility, it's the quality, it's the health, it's the safety. All of those dynamics come into it on the conflict of interest side. Same dynamics, you still got to apply those kinds of things. And so it is easy to get caught up in discussions of what's ethical and is this rights-based or not, and who gets to exercise all those rights. But on that issue of rights and responsibilities, so here we are, we have the right to have firearms, but you got to use those, safely and following the community's laws and norms. I would imagine a little south of us, this would be a fairly controversial example to use. But the next page gets into some examples of, sort of that, the two sides of this particular coin or that continuum that we're dealing with in terms of rights, distinguishing between rights and responsibilities. And so, safe environment versus the responsibility, the right to your opinion versus, others, right to education versus, essentially living your best life possible. The right to a clean environment for responsibility versus your responsibility to be a good steward. Adequate housing to looking after the house that you get or you buy or you own. Whether that's the band that owns it or the family that owns it or the individual that owns it or lives in it. So again, that dynamic there. Communicating decisions. We touched on this a little bit. What this one tries to get at is, really effective communications, both here we talk about internal and external. They're pretty similar when you look at this in the next slide. Just be about sensitive, diplomatic, careful in what you're able to reveal and what you can't reveal. I do find it's good to be upfront about that. People understand when you tell them you can't, when you can't do stuff. People will forgive you over the course of the long term. You can't spill your guts. And it's not a he said situation, particularly when you're speaking in an official capacity as a council member, as a board member, a senior manager, a supervisor. There's guardrails there for sure. But how do you then, within that, those guardrails, have the most effective, most transparent conversation that you can? And in many ways, you do want a conversation that is problem solving and consensus building. Again, that's a real skill, effective communication. I would recommend this as another professional development thing. I often will often say to people, we have these things that we don't like to do in our work, it's important to look at those as signals of the need for professional development. Or as I like to say, rather than some great moral failing of my own, I just recognize that as someplace I need to, up my game. As a lifelong learner, being prepared to do that. So again, just being careful when communicating with your community or the stakeholders or the circle of parties that are involved, really need to know, right? And let's go to the external one because it just really just emphasize that. And sometimes internal could mean, parties. External means that extended circle of family and friends and interested parties who will ask to that. Again, these are just good, effective communication practices. Here, especially when you're getting outside of the immediate circle, you got to be, I think, even more careful. So let's say you're dealing with the staff. There's HR policies and procedures. And again, that contains that. And there's places to go. There's off ramps for those sensitive conversations or differing opinions and positions. Externally, when you're talking to the community or other family members, there's not as much of that structure there. So you could see here, this is a lot narrower than what we would talk about in the one above. Questions leaders might ask, let's move to that. In many ways, what this one is getting at is not only it's when I keep talking about that serious introspection, this is trying to get at that. Things to ask yourself, but in many ways, things to ask about, does your policy and process allow you to do that And then things to ask yourself about, how am I conducting myself when I'm in those situations? So, here's some good, good things to keep in mind. Sometimes we have these nice placemats that we'll use, literal placemats where we'll put our strategic plan and becomes a blotter, and we use those. On the other side of that, it wouldn't hurt to put something like this in terms of the conflict of interest policy or some key policies as a council in terms of our conduct. That I've seen that as a nice tool to keep both strategic planning content relevant and present, but also, let's say, your foundational information from your foundational documents and your policies and procedures, sort of the Coles notes of that readily available to you. Here in BC and the First Nations Health Council work, at the governance level and the political level of that work, they were really effective at doing that. And I believe their First Nations Health Authority Board, which was then governing the delivery of services, did that as well. And so it was a really useful tool. I remember there was a phase where we all went through where these placemats were a really big thing. I do find them effective. This is another thing that could help you in that policy process of a council meeting, of a management meeting, of an HR situation as well. Deciding to be ethical is our next slide. And in some ways, these are not deciding to be ethical, but these are more sort of how to really think about these things: ethics, morals, values, conflict of interest, perception of conflict of interest, breach, policy and process, policy and procedures. You need it to be professional and concrete, but you also need it to be like this. You got to be able to see the story in it and tell the story of it without saying section one, subsection two says our policy procedure is, A, B. Like, you got to be able to explain this and communicate it, as mentioned, both overall and in each specific situation, depending on your audience. I do like this last saying, this saying here. If people are dishonest, making them take a course won't make them honest. Again, it comes to our character. It comes to how we apply, our beliefs about what's right and wrong. Again, I call them guardrails on purpose, because again, that will help you deal with that. This is not necessarily about changing a person's personality, but it is saying that in our work, in our organizations, in our business, this is our standard of behavior. These are our norms. This is how we conduct ourselves. And we ask you to join us in doing that. I like this last one too. There is no right way to do a wrong thing. I'll let that one stand on its own. But in a way, really this course has said, we have to apply it personally, we've got to apply it organizationally, we've got to apply it structurally. There are good ways to do that. There are no perfect ways. Again, that idea of problem solving is conflict resolution. And time and time, in the training, what I learned on conflict management was get comfortable with conflict. And navigating conflict, and understand that there is a way to navigate conflict, to have those conversations about conflict. And there are good, it's necessary to have processes for resolving conflict. That's why, in a governance context, we have a judicial arm, so that, it manages different sets of conflicts. But, even in an interpersonal situation, you do need to have that there. So, we're not great at talking about conflict. And from a facilitating point of view, merely putting your finger on the conflict issue or the tension point or the delicate topic in diplomatic ways and clarifying ways is often enough for people to sort of step back because they're not comfortable with conflict. So, you know, and but you're trying to say, you know, we got to get to that place where we can have that conversation. Can't avoid the emotional content, can't avoid the triggering content. But as I joke often, like, let's not treat it as a moral failure. Let's treat it as a professional, personal, and organizational development need that can be resolved. With that, that brings us to the end of our slides. So I will wrap up there and to look to see, Spencer, in terms of our time available and whether there are additional questions.
So we are running maybe 5 or 6 minutes over, but this is the last webinar. So if anybody has any questions that you want to ask Harold before we end, you can type them now. And I just want to give a big virtual round of applause to Harold for doing this 4 back-to-back webinars and providing us all this great information and things to think about. So thank you, Harold.
Thank you very much, Spencer. I do appreciate that. I want to thank everybody for their participation. Yeah, that's why I wasn't sure about the time because some of them started at top of the hour, 15 after, 15 yeah. before. It wasn't positive. So anyway, it was good. I do see the participants list. So it was good to see you all today. And so with that, I'll turn it back to Spencer and we shall conclude. Take care, everybody.
Yep. Okay.
And I'm sure I will see you. I was sure I will see you down the road soon, at least 6 feet apart.
Okay, so the meeting is officially over here, and just notes on people talking about the presentations. We will send out PowerPoints, and we will send out a link to the recording for this. So you'll receive that on your email.
Ah, yes, and a little advertising. AFOA Canada National Conference, February 2023, returning to their tradition of meeting on Valentine's Day. All right, everybody. See you there.